Cool. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Thirsty Therapy. We're joining you today from the lovely Pacific Northwest, and it is beautiful and cold, and we're happy to have you with us. John, how are you doing out there?
Good. Ready to
Nice.
stay warm with some rum.
Heck yeah. And thank goodness we got it too, because it is going to definitely help with that. So, since we are working with rums, I got a bunch of good ones up here, kind of spanning some of the flavor profiles from lighter to darker, and nothing too heavily spiced. I am forgetting the one that you and I like so well, the overproof from
Smith and
Plantation.
Cross.
No, yeah. I should have brought that out up here. It should definitely be out here. But alas, it got missed tonight. We
Can I
do
tell you
have.
why I suggested rum for tonight?
I can't wait to know. Yeah, this was your call.
It's very simple. I do like rum, but I didn't, and I saw we're going to colder months. I thought of it. But I also want to show that it's more than just that. Yearly eggnog or hot toddy.
Right.
What do you think of that?
I think it's perfect. I think especially based on what we're gonna play around with and make tonight. Yeah, I think we're gonna show that. I think we're gonna show the depth that we can add to it, and then the depth that it holds itself, of flavor. And it is. It's great for the summertime, but it lends such a nice rich flavor, and the funky Hugo to, so many like layers of flavor for a cocktail. Kinderlift, welcome back. Nice to see you. It is a new era. Thanks for coming in tonight. So, as John and I are talking about, we're already talking about rum. We got some good ones. John, what are you working with over on your side?
Well, I am. Oh, rum wine?
Yeah, rum-wise. I mean, you already mentioned Smith and Cross. I wasn't sure if you actually had any out. I know that it happens to be one of your favorites.
That's always got a place on in my bar.
That's awesome. As it should.
It's a dedicated place. But we're starting out pretty simple today. The rums we're using are pretty widely available, right?
Right, we're not going to hurt anybody with these rums. We're really, really starting off, and we're making them approachable as we're adding some of those funkier flavors in.
And they're
It's
not the rums that you drank in college either.
so much, so far from that. There's no sweetener in them. There's no fake coconut flavor. We have a lighter crystal rum here that we can use for a lot of things. In fact, that happens. The viscosity of rum happens to be better for me than vodka when it comes to certain infusions. So I use Don Q every time I make this fantastic bitter cacao rum. It's actually a part of a cocktail mix that I mix up with orange habanero, orange peel habanero, brown sugar syrup. Kind of make almost like a mole with the chocolate in there. But I love what it lends itself. We have Magdalena up here on my side. That is produced here in Portland, by House Spirits, in fact. The interesting thing is it's grown in Guatemala. They ship it up here and then they put it in barrels and age it just slightly here before they bottle it. And then we got our plantation. That's going to be the first one that we're going to work with tonight. That's the three star. Using three different bases of rum, adding a little bit of funky layers to the whole thing. Sorry, no Captain Morgan tonight. We're not using that particular spiced rum, but we're going to add spices to it because we can control those a little bit better. Captain Morgan from batch to batch can vary a little more than we want it to. But we may, who knows, we may have a whole night of just featuring all Captain Morgan things. And then last up, we're going to do a Solera rum, which is from Venezuela. It is very, very dark, very aged, fantastic, rich molasses flavors that we're going to get out of that. And yeah, I think we're going to have a lot of fun making some goodies here. Johnny, ready to get started, or should we talk about rum a little bit more?
I think I'm almost ready to get started. I do want to acknowledge the current events.
Yeah,
the fact that we have a hell of an opener, an opening act right now.
Right. Yeah. Right now,
The president-elect is giving a speech, right?
Yeah, and I turned it into Kamala Harris, and hearing her actually give her speech and then introduce President-elect Joe Biden. It is, yeah, it's a lot to compete with at this point.
So after a tumultuous week, yeah, it's a lot to compete with, but I think we can all agree we're going to want to drink and sit down and talk about it.
Yeah, and have a moment and decompress from the tight bound fetal position we've been all holding on to a little bit too tightly.
A countrywide anxiety, yeah. I mean that on for everybody. Like this, it was a long week.
No matter who you wanted to win, I feel like everybody is at that kind of point. It reminds me though of a conversation I had 2 weeks ago with a complete stranger standing in line, socially distanced, but standing in line waiting in a grocery store, and we were able to talk through our masks quite well, and it was interesting how he brought up his anxiety, and knowing full well, I'm sure that we all felt it, but his was more pointed, and I couldn't help but even realize at that time that the bigger thing, and this got us talking about a lot, but the biggest thing about all this is we're not as different as we all have felt like we are in the last few years. We all still want the best for our kids. We all still want a fair shake and a chance for all of us to get, you know, to work hard and earn what we can. And I'm excited for people to start, hopeful for people to start remembering that.
Healing, if you will.
Yeah. But also just being open to it and realizing that, we can always find all of our divisions. It's really, those are the easiest things to find, especially with our pattern recognition brains. The harder and the challenge and the more rewarding thing is to start seeing what we do like about each other and what we can get along with. Then healing can come. I don't think you can even start healing until,
got it,
you know, you actually open up to it. So that should be said. Well, we all have a little bit of work to do to open up, but I think we can get there.
So on that note, thirsty?
What? I am. I think everybody else out there is too, right? Maddie Light, thank you so much for joining us. All right, let's get started on a drink then. So the first one we're going to do tonight, we're going to do a shake and drink. And that is because we're going to use juices that we want to emulsify into our alcohol. So what we're going to start off with, and this cocktail is inspired by John. He got me opening up to more funky rums, right? And he did so with these daiquiris. And we started off doing flavors that are a little bit like this, where we did combinations of a little bit stronger flavored rums with a little bit of lighter flavored rums. This already does it for us. Plantation 3-Star. It's just got a little bit of that Hugo on the back. But we're not going to make it too complicated. So actually, I'm going to set this aside for now. We're going to start off with our least expensive things. So we're going to start off with, thanks, Pikachu. I don't choose you. I need lime juice. I'm gonna hang out in there for a minute. All right, so we need lime juice. We need pineapple juice. We're going to do rum. And our sweetener tonight, it's going to be a little bit different. John, I wanted a little bit of fluff in this cocktail, and the viscosity of agave is going to give it to us. So let's start off with our non-alcohol cocktails first. Welcome in, everybody. Tough gum. And what we're going to do that way, if we screw up, we're not wasting alcohol. We're just wasting a little bit of juice. So, John, you got the specs up there. Thank you so much. What we're going to do is we're going to skip straight to that lime juice and pineapple juice. I got the pineapple here, so we'll do a half ounce of that. Nice steady pour. That's why I'm always keeping my fingers out. Lime juice is going to be our next ingredient. We want this to be a little bit tart, a little more dry, so we're going to go 3/4 of an ounce. And remember, we said that for everybody out there, we don't want to hurt anybody. Right, so we're gonna make this nice and juicy, easy for anybody to get behind, taste those great flavors. And then there's a 1/2 ounce of light blue agave. We're gonna let it hang there for a minute because it takes a little while to drip. If I was thinking right, I'd rinse it with my juice, but. All right. So last up, that lovely plantation 3-star. We're gonna do 2 ounces of that tonight.
Can you show that bottle?
Actually, let's get a good.
Yeah. Star of the show of this pumpkin.
Yeah, in fact, I'm interested to see what everybody thinks when they go out and get a chance to test all this. Now, ice the whole thing down. And we're gonna put our tins together. We're gonna give them a quick pound. That way they actually like stay nice and tight together and you get the seal. And this one, since John, remember we said we wanted a little bit of froth and a little bit of whip. We are gonna shake it really, really hard. Japanese hard shake style, so 2 hands. Back and forth. It's only going to need to be about 30 seconds. Then we're going to crack it. Get all that extra fantastic drippage. And tonight, I'm going to use a coupe for this cocktail. We are going to double strain. Just because we like to be fancy like that. But I'm going to do it from a height tonight. Just a little bit higher than I normally would. Because I want some of that whippy foam that we're going to get from the pineapple juice. Look at that great ribbon. Tap out the extra.
I'm waiting to take mine. I want to see exactly what you're doing.
Well. I've got that cocktail right there, ready to go. And the next thing we're gonna do, you want me to garnish it next? We're gonna garnish, and what we're doing tonight is we're gonna do a little bit of Burberry spice. So pineapple's coming into season, and but we really wanna add a nice tropical flavor to it, and I'm using Burberry, which is a East African spice. Fenugreek, coriander and chili pepper tend to be the most predominant flavors that are coming through, and they work really, really well with the pineapple. Nice hard shake, sir. So as we do that, John, after you get your pour on, we're going to garnish with a little bit of this Burberry. I poured some right into my hand, so everything that I gave you, just pour it right in your hand, and I'm gonna pinch and just make one fun little line there. Now, how about you, John, from where you're at, since I can't see your cocktail, are you getting a good foam going across the top? Or just a little bit of foam?
I think I need to get braver. I think I need to get a little bit of, yeah.
A little bit
more than a regular daiquiri and a classic daiquiri. I got to get more brave with the high pour. That's pretty fancy.
We'll get there. So all I'm doing is stirring this across once we get the line in there. And me, I actually went backwards. But it'll make almost a teardrop or an E in yours if you don't do what I did. But the idea is that you're just spreading a little bit out throughout the whole cocktail. Gives it a little bit of a cute finish. But the bigger purpose of this whole thing is for you to get it on your nose as you're bringing the cocktail up to take a sip. And then it's slowly going to dissipate. All those spices are going to drop down into the cocktail. And then you're going to get less on your nose and a little bit more on your tongue, with the most intense part on your finish, the very, very last couple sips. Welcome in, everybody. I'm glad you love that mini fridge, too. I am so lucky my wife donated it to Thirsty Therapy here. What do you think, John? You ready for a sip? Cheers, everybody.
One more time. Spreading it across the top, did you do anything with it? Did you, like, stir it through or make a shape or anything?
What we're going to do is I want you to grab both sides of the glass and just rotate it clockwise. Maybe, like, 5 times. Make sure you're going the same way. Otherwise, you'll end up like me and have a blob. But if you do 5 slow, gentle rotations, it should be, like, a nice, cool gas streak almost. And the way I started drinking it when I was testing this is I ended up having the first few sips with just the tip, the tail end of that.
Okay, well, now I'm caught up. Cheers again.
Cheers, sir. Please.
That's good.
Yeah, good. I'm so glad you like it. Pikachu's holding on to everything in here. Thank goodness. I'm glad you're enjoying it too, Kinderlip. That's awesome. Yep, Burberry is a strange thing to pronounce. I've heard it pronounced so many different ways. In fact, just before we went on the air tonight, we double checked just to see if we could confirm that. And there was someone from Ethiopia who insisted that it was Burberry, and I'm going with it. So, John, does it have everything you were hoping for? That nice balance? I know that normally you like it a little bit drier, so I know this is making it a little more juicy with the pineapple.
Do I like it drier? I don't know. I think of myself as a sweet tooth.
That's true.
Sometimes it's good to have it dry. This is great. This is great. Everybody needs pineapple in their lives right now. It's a celebration.
Right? And when I mentioned drier, I know that most of the time our specs for you have been closer to like 3/4 of an ounce of sweetener and a full ounce of lime juice. So I know this adds.
Oh, I see what you mean.
That's the strange part about pineapple is you don't want to. It adds sweetness and tartness to the whole thing. So I have to kind of readjust those specs a little bit.
Technically, I do like it drier.
Right. Yeah.
But this is great, juicy. I mean, who wouldn't like this? And that spice on top is really nice because you don't usually think of, I don't know. I don't traditionally combine lime and spice, but obviously it's a winning combination.
It has so much. I'm only gleaming this off all the fantastic people from around the world that have introduced me to lime and spice and citrus and spice. Like, so many different cultures of food have been from Thai to Cambodian to Indian. There's so many different options that are out there, or different examples that are out there. And that's my favorite thing about the world we live in. We have so we can learn from so many different places. And you and I have talked about how cool it'd be to be in Central America and just try the different fruits and vegetables that they have down there that aren't available to us here. And I think that just throws options to everything that we can create from there. So. We got this fantastic cocktail. I'm really happy with the way it turned out. Plus, I love having that spice. And there's something about fenugreek that I will never, ever hate. I've put it in way too many things. But it's so interesting to me how you can have that rounded caramely flavor out of a hard spice, a seed.
Yeah, wow. Wow. Yeah, I'm going to have to add this into my rotation. This is a daiquiri riff, mm-hmm. right?
That's all it is.
This is very close to a classic daiquiri. I'm going to have to add this to the repertoire. This is, yeah.
Easy and fun.
Spice, juicy, easy, yeah.
It could be fun, too, coming into season now, because it is wintertime is our pineapple season. We end up having a great time to get really, really overripe pineapples, and we can turn those into a really pungent syrup, pineapple syrup, and make it a rich syrup. And then that can take the same could take the same place of the pineapple juice. That'd be a fun one to try. I'm all about that seasonality. So whatever we can think of. I agree. Fenugreek is so good. Tough Gum Berber is, let's see, one of my favorite things, and how I was introduced to it was like, what are all these flavor combinations, was African peanut soup or peanut stew. And that's how I learned about Burberry originally. This happens to be not the first cocktail I've put it in as well. I have another cocktail that utilizes macadamia nut milk and pandan, a pandan syrup, as well as bourbon and Burberry spice to finish it off. That one happened to be inspired to be a tiki drink. So making it as tiki as I could. John, you know tiki drinks even better than I do. What I've learned is that there tends to be a spice or a spiced rum on top for aromatics on a lot of things. So that's what gave me the idea of adding that to this. I ended up calling it a boozy vegan milkshake, essentially. It had a cooler name than that, but that's in essence what it was. Pandan? Pandan happens to be a... it is a deciduous leaf. Not deciduous. What looks like a raffia palm leaf, almost. Really, really long. And you know what? That's a great question. I actually have some just behind camera. I'm going to step off for about 10 seconds. Just because what are the odds that I actually have some around when we're talking about it? I happen to be making some new Thai bitters. And this is one of the ingredients. And basically the Thai bitters just ended up being all the quintessential flavors that I love in Thai food, and how I could add those. Quintessential vegetable flavors, I guess I would say. But this is trimmed and pretty. Usually they're a little bit bigger, something just like this. But the fact that pandan or pandanus has a great almondy nutty flavor, you can take this alone, chop it up, and put it in a little bit of water, and it will make it taste like almost like toasted rice water, which is really interesting and delicious. And Andy Ricker, who just actually closed the last and original Pock Pock, he introduced me to that. He actually used to put it in the water for all of his restaurants. And yeah, just came to your table. I was like, is this rice water? I'm not sure if you should be drinking this, but it tastes delicious. Did you hear?
R.I.P. Pock Pock.
Right? I don't know. Just going to
say. Is there any way we can, you know, like certain political decisions, election results, I don't want to be pushed back against and reversed, but can we like petition or, you know, for Pock Pock to come back?
Man, I wish we could. It would be so nice. I mean, they did such a great job, but I can't say that I blame Andy right now. I mean, look at the situation that we're all in, and brings us even closer connections right now is because of what we're working with the our pandemic and everything else. Not that this isn't a something that we can do all the time, but yeah.
An interesting time.
Right? So, I mean, the fact that it'd be really hard to bring your restaurant back, you'd be going into debt for I don't know, the next 6 months to a year before you could even start pulling yourself out. And I read his letter to everybody saying goodbye. Oh man, if we could only get a recount. Target Tarts, that's awesome. I can't say I blame him. We've been doing it for a long time. You know, like he's been doing this 20 years longer than I have, and I've been doing this for 20 years. I could see how he's not ready to build it all back up from scratch again after everything hit. I think that there are a lot of places out there that need real help and real relief, and they're not getting it. And as we all heard several times over, how many other people have taken advantage of the money that should have gone to people that keep our communities kind of together and going. And yeah, I'm excited to see where our industry goes from here and how it evolves and how it changes and what it bounces back to. Oh man, Kinderlift, you're not kidding. Thai food, Thailand. Mm. And the coolest part was that he was doing Northern Thailand, which is things that aren't necessarily readily available to all of us or seen all the time. So it's nice that somebody took the chance and everybody proved how much they appreciated him showing it off. So on that note, back to that spice blend that we know and love. So John, what brought you into your love for rum? Where was the first place you went that you were like, other than college, it's got to be beyond coconut rum in college, since we already went over that.
That's right. It was a rum enthusiast who runs, he has a big collection of rum in his house, and he's known by his friends for liking rum, so they go on trips to the Caribbean, some country he's never been to maybe, and bring him back obscure rums. And he teaches classes in his own home. And I don't know, if any situation where you get me in a
that's
like,
awesome.
Taste these 10 different things, just a nip from each, you know, don't get wasted on them. And you know, tell me the differences and note the differences. Oh, I just go nuts. And it was a spirit that I had disregarded before because of maybe college experiences, or it's too simple, it's not as robust as whiskey. He changed my mind. He showed me things I'd never seen before.
Right, there's so much out there. What do you remember the first one or two that he started you off on that got you excited for the journey?
I can tell you his gateway drug for other people, which worked on me as well. Diplomatico Reserva.
I'm familiar with the name, but I don't think I know the flavor.
It's pretty. It's on the sweeter side. It might be a sugared rum, in fact. But I mean, it's pretty good just by itself. Like, you didn't need to mix it with Coke.
Right.
It was.
That's always
like
a good sign.
I like this by itself. This is great.
I don't have to have this with soda or with coconut milk and pineapple.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome.
But then he takes you through other islands, and that's a pretty straightforward one. I think it'll be palatable to most people, but you go to Jamaica and you go to the French agricole rums, and totally different flavors.
Insanely different flavors. To think about that they're all from rums, that they're all still the same forms of rum. They're all starting off with sugarcane and moving from there. Yeah, that's interesting. Well, and then you have the different pits that they throw, the fermentation pits that they throw things in and take things right out of the fermentation pit to purposefully add that like funky, heavy rotten banana flavor almost to it, which I enjoy,
yeah,
but we
right.
tend to enjoy those things. But yeah,
right,
perfectly
right.
safe. You're perfectly safe. It's totally inoculated. There's nothing that's going to hurt you, but except for the flavor the first time you try it. Kinderlift, you're
oh, yeah,
right. Sorry, John. I was going to tell him there are some Portland rums. Like, it Magdalena that we were talking about at the beginning, so far, that's the only Portland rum that I know of. But again, they're bringing up the unaged rum after it's already made from Guatemala, and then to age it here with coconut, I think, too. Coconut husk, if I'm right, which does give it this fantastic color and flavor.
Portland rum.
Yeah. That's the Magdalena here. House Spirits, who also makes Aviation Gin. Ooh, there we go. Nice.
Can leave that out.
We'll put it right there.
Wait, how does that differ from the one we just tasted in this daiquiri?
Ah, it is much more like a light rum than anything else. Flavor-wise, there is no jugo, there is no like funkiness, not even like in the background. The light flavor or the light aging tends to give it a little bit of like a slight turn of carameliness to it. It is, as far as price-wise, it is right about the same as Bacardi. And so, of course, I'm going to support House Spirits and all those fantastic folks I've been able to work with for years here. Through many different
support
restaurants
local. I've worked
with. Support local. Shouldn't we always? Especially when we're in a place like this. We have such,
as I prefer to say, Supportland.
Right. If you were in Seattle, it'd be the same way, though. I mean, the fact that people are really taking the time to make well-crafted quality ingredients or quality products out of local ingredients, no matter where you are in the country, I hope that you're doing that for the people that are doing, you know, a good job and doing well. So support them, help them keep going. Nothing better than I love seeing somebody succeed at doing something right and well, and not necessarily trying to do 50,000 different things, but just doing that one thing and doing it really well. Aria Gin, I've known them and worked with them for years. They're a Portland gin company. He's done some aging. Yeah, great flavor profile, good orris root. He's done some aging with his some of his gins, but still just sticking to the gin. He worked with some other distillers here in town, and he could have done so many. You're right, it is so good. He could have gone on and done so many other different types of liquor, and he didn't. He just stuck with doing Aria, and he did it well, and they don't have to take it too much further than that. They're aging it in sherry casks and some other things. What I appreciate is to professionals, especially like bar managers and their teams that are local, and they want to work with their product or their Aria, then they can actually go into Aria's testing lab or testing bar and make cocktails and for free, and just to try them out so they don't waste too much of their own budget and their own bar on trying out the cocktails. That's how much he believes in his product, and that's amazing. Can't ask for more than that. So, with that being said,
going back to this rum, though, I wanted to quickly check just to illustrate the difference. If we were to put this in the same drink,
would you change
anything?
That's a good question.
Because the Magdalena, so the three-star is three stars because it's three islands, Jamaica, Barbados, Trinidad.
Right. So would I have...
And the Magdalena is like more one note or lighter?
It is completely one note. And it is 100% lighter. There's no like funky, heavy richness on the end of it. So I would say that it's just giving me a little bit of extra depth off, a slight extra depth compared to a lighter rum. Now, it's a better quality. It's not as quick, as mass-produced as Don Q. It's small batch. But flavor-wise, you're not getting tons more. You're getting a little more viscosity out of the Magdalena and a little bit more richness because of the aging process. whether or not I would have changed the cocktail, I would have tried to add something. Well, the thing I like about the three star is that it does have a little bit of that funkiness. So I think I would have tried to brighten it up, and I would have changed the sweetener. I think I would have almost insisted that we used honey if we used the Magdalena. Because the minerality that you're going to get with honey and a little bit of, you know, where you almost have that little bit of ironiness in there. That would have needed a little bit more. This one would have, that the Plantation already gives. And the Berber spice, I think we would have had to shake into the cocktail and then also put on top.
Oh, wow.
Because you would have want, it would have needed to make up for the loss of flavor.
All right. Let's hear it for three star.
Right.
One more depth.
There it is. So, Kinderlift for newbies, what's the number one thing you should not do with rum? There's not a rule for that. You're free, sir, please, or madam. You should be more open than I think most people would think to be with rum. In fact, John, you and I, you'd come in to see me at a place called Afuri, a Japanese ramen restaurant. And they happen to have a cocktail with yuzu, lime, and rum in it. Do you remember that one?
Oh, most definitely.
Well, that one, I had so many people walk up to me and say, you know, I hate rum. Everything about this cocktail sounds fantastic, except for the rum. Can you go ahead and take out the rum or put vodka in there or something else? And I'd have to insist almost every time, like, I could do that and you'd go walk away, but you're not going to be happy with what it is. And you'd be shocked. You know, if everything else sounds good to you, let me just make this cocktail for you and you taste it. It's not a spice rum. It's not a coconut rum. It's a really clean, light, clear rum, and I think people have misconceptions about what they can do or what it's going to do to them or for them, or, that it only has to be in tiki drinks or party drinks. And tonight we're going to show you our second cocktail when we get to it in a little while. In fact, is going to be an old fashioned using Solera rum. And that's going to be a stirred cocktail with not much more than, you know, stirring it with ice, diluting it and adding some bitters and a little bit of sweetener. But you're going to see, you could do that. You'd have to add some other things to this crystal rum if you wanted to turn that into an old fashioned, but you could do it. I've had somebody tell me that they wanted an old fashioned with vodka, and I've been able to make it happen. We happen to use a potato vodka that was very expensive, made from Yukon Gold potatoes, but it was a very acceptable old fashioned. I was very pleasantly surprised and proud that I could serve that to somebody and it held up as an old fashioned.
Wow.
Yeah, you never think that, right? But I think we end up wanting to box ourselves in with our ingredients that we're working with, and we don't have to worry about it. The rum drink that I told all of you about a little while ago with Don Q, infused with bitter cacao. I mix with tequila. I have a tequila drink that you mix Aria gin with. When you're searching for a flavor profile and you're trying to go at it like you would cooking, at least that's how I go at it. Like when I want this flavor, and I'll take whatever ingredients I have to get there and tweak them as we go and add things as we need it. So outside of that, you can't make any huge mistakes as long as you try and keep things simple. I think the biggest thing to keep in mind is that a daiquiri like John and I were doing is technically 2 ounces of rum, 1 ounce of lime juice, and 3/4 of an ounce of syrup, simple syrup. And that's it. And you shake it up and you drink it. It's freaking delicious. It doesn't matter which one of these. Look, we'll put them all four up here. Doesn't matter which one of these rums you use. You'll be happy, it'll be balanced, and you won't get scurvy. So can you ask for any more in your life? Right?
Movies in 2020, that would be the worst.
That would be 2020 at this point. That would be. Everybody be dropping off with scurvy all of a sudden. This yuzu lime concoction, the only other thing was honey, and you're going to use a honey syrup. It is fantastic and delicious. And you can play around with the yuzu and the lime, and you don't have to, that ends up being your taste. And you, like John said, it's easier to start off with sweeter things than too dry. But then again, you can always add sweetener to it. It just definitely don't burn yourself on it. You'll never want to come back. So we have a honey syrup is a, I like making it in a 2-to-1, mixture. We're using undiluted product tonight, and that also works. Agave happens to work really well, and you could always use that in place of honey if you wanted. It doesn't really need to be diluted too bad. You just have to know that it's just as strong, if not a little bit sweeter than sugar. So you're going to adjust from there. But honey, the only reason I do a 2-to-1 is it comes out of a, it pours out a little bit easier. So if I'm at a bar that we're really, really busy and I'm making 600 cocktails that night, I want them to come out as quick as I can. And yeah, you don't want to be waiting there for honey. And each cocktail takes 6 minutes, then you're dead. Can't keep up. Oh, John, cheers again, man. It just hit me. We have had a relieving day a little bit. Hope it stays this way.
Yeah.
Well, with everybody out there,
rum. Do we need to talk about that?
Talk about, right? I guess not. We could just be happy and just keep talking about rum. But I wanted to take a second to thank everybody for joining us out there. I think it is fantastic seeing all of you here. Thank you for all your comments and taking a few minutes to hang out with us. We, John and I, have put together some fun cocktails for you, a little bit of knowledge. Who knows? John, we may just get crazy and do trivia one of these nights if we're bored. The sky's the limit when it comes to Twitch, right?
Oh, yeah. All the unexploited ideas.
Right. Just as long as everybody has a great time. That's all we're here for. Thirsty therapy, John and I are doing because we want some way to connect with all of you out there. Have a little taste of bar and cocktail life. And it's a socially safe way to approach a bar right now. Yeah, infectious disease trivia, I think, would be the first and last category that we would want to do for sure. Send us all back into our sad, sad holes. Well, should we start with our next cocktail, John? Or are we jumping the gun a little?
No, I'm ready. We can talk a little bit after that.
I think we should. John, now before we get started, I realized that I didn't get a chance to tell you that we were going to be doing, that I was doing a BFC in a rocks glass, but for some reason I thought you might've already guessed it. Were you already there?
Why do you ask?
I was just wondering, I wasn't sure if you wanted to get it ready, because Pikachu's already got mine rocking right here.
Sure, I'll put a glass in the freezer.
I thought I'd give you a chance. You got a BFC around though, John, since I didn't remember to remind you about it? Oh, good. Perfect. I figured you would. You always have the great setup.
But remind the viewers at home, what is a BFC?
A BFC, tonight we'll call it a big fancy cube.
Big fancy cube.
Big fancy cube. That's for the kids. Yeah. But really, that's all it is. It's a big, huge cube. The idea of us putting this onto our big fudging cup, I like that one better, These cubes, they just tend to let us chill down a drink, and especially with the stirred drink that we're going to do, we're not going to over dilute it, but we want to get a good dilution with some regular ice, and then we're going to pour it over a big cube. The idea behind that is that it's slower to melt. It won't water down your drink too fast. Plus, they just look really, really cool. And if we start getting good at them, we're going to get flowers and different fun things inside. Oh, penicillin. Yeah, me too. That's a fantastic one. And nice smokiness right on top. So we are going to start off with, for this old fashioned, I am going to grab my Yarai. We're stirring vessel here. This one happens to be from Bullen, China, here in town. Handmade, another fantastic local thing to support. And oddly enough, I'm going to start this one the opposite of the way we did the other. And we're going to start off with Solera rum, just like John's showing you right now. So the Solera is going to go 2 ounces. And make sure that when we're doing this, this is a 2 ounce jigger. You're going to go all the way to the top until you get that bubble. It's called your meniscus. And that is the only way that you're ensuring you're getting a full 2 ounce measure. Outside of that, if that's too hard and it does take a little bit of practice, you've got all these fantastic lines inside your jigger. And you can go with a 1/2 ounce and then a 1.5 ounce over on this side. And it makes it just a little bit more approachable. And you don't have to do the fancy hand holding like I tend to do that keeps my hand nice and nice steady. So,
well, we're building the drink, can you show off that rum?
Yeah, great idea, John. Thanks for reminding me.
It's quite different than the first one.
It's so different than the first one. So,
totally different bottle, dark color.
Fell in love. Somebody introduced me, Eric Nielsen introduced this to me with Shipwreck. It was a pop-up bar that he does. And I didn't know this rum existed. And I appreciate everything I'm able to learn from anybody who's willing to teach me. And that is introducing us to new flavors and new ideas and things that can be combined really, really well. And just like Kinderlift brought up, I didn't think I could make an old fashioned with rum before this. And it helps. It helps having these new products and these new ideas of flavor. It reminds me of things like Singani, which is a new form of almost like a pisco, but it's not because it's made in a different region of Central America, South America. But the idea that you can get such different and unique flavors just by doing the very, very similar technique, a very, very similar technique in a different location with different water, or even just slightly different plant material. It's kind of like John, you and I with sake, right? Like sake's rice, water, koji, and yeast. But depending on how you change each one of those 5 ingredients, it vastly changes the flavor that you're going to finish with. So just like some of us out there, I didn't think we could do it with rum, but this one brought me out of my shell. So 2 ounces. And then because we're getting into these fall winter months and I wanted to go with the rich flavors that we were already working with, John and I are going to do 100% maple syrup. Now, we're not going to dilute this one down just like I do in the bar, behind the bar in a very busy restaurant. We would dilute down any of these, but this one doesn't need it for here. In fact, here's what we're going to do. We're going to switch around. We're going to go to 0.25 ounces. We don't need very much, and because we're not diluting it at all, I'd only put 0.25 ounces of any syrup in an old fashioned. And because we talked about rum being derived from sugarcane originally as well, it already has a viscosity and I don't know whether I'd call it an openness to sweetness. It tends to like to hold on to sweetness really well. So that's all we're going to need. It's going to be really nice and balanced. We're also going to do 2 different bitters for this one. Going with our nice rich fall theme, we're going to go with Portland Bitter Project. They have a pitch dark cow bitters. I love this one. When I first met the owner of Portland Bitter Project, John, you got a mini one I sent you home with. When I first met the owner of Portland Bitter Project, it was after somebody had gotten me a sample pack. And I walked up to her and I was like, I can't make a better bitter chocolate bitters. And she was just like, wait, you're trying to, and I was like, yeah, I make bitters on my own, but I can't make it as good as you make it. It's won me over. And I love that. I love that we all can do some unique things out there and still have a place. So what I'm doing with this, John, is I'm doing 15 drops. I'm at 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 now of chocolate or this bitter cacao. And as I already said, 15. I tend to make bitters on my own too. So we have one of my favorites and my most my most loved, in fact. A buddy of mine took this to Kentucky and won an old fashioned contest with it. So while he said, well, you know, I had to make the drink, which I appreciated. He did have to make a good drink and keep his stuff clean. But also, an old fashioned isn't much other than bitters and bourbon. So I felt pretty good knowing that it helped him help push his flavors over. So this one is, we're going to do 5 drops of this.
What's this other one?
This is a spiced pecan. So it was it started off as an aromatic coffee pecan. That's a mouthful. But spiced pecan encompasses everything, all the flavors that you're going to get in there. There's a little bit of coffee. There's a little bit of chocolate. There is, wow.
Smells so good. I just had some by itself.
I'm so glad. Good. No, and as you should. And John, you just brought up a fantastic point. In fact, I want to show everybody how to taste a bitters if they actually were curious about tasting it. And it's not something you're ever going to, please don't ever drop it in your mouth, even though it's got a dropper that you would expect to take children's Tylenol with or something. When you end up doing it, and John, I'm going to switch down to my hand angle. We're going to just take our hands right here and we're going to drop just 1 or 2 drops right there on your hand. And here's the weird part. The reason you're doing that is because you want to take a lick straight off the top of your hand like that. Now, the reason you're doing this is because bitters is complex and there's so many different flavors that are built into it, and they're meant to do different things. And the most poignant parts of your tongue aren't necessarily the ones that are right on the tip. So when you're putting it on that part of your hand and you're getting a full lick going across your hand, like with your tongue going across like that, it actually spreads it to every part of your tongue so that you get every sensation. You can actually get the full true flavor that you normally wouldn't there. So John, are you ready? You got all your bitters in. We got our maple. We have our Solera rum. We're good to go. Let's add our ice next.
Yeah.
Now, this one is going to be a stir drink.
When you fill your mixing glass with ice, how much ice do you need?
I like going just above half to 3/4, depending on the cocktail that you're doing. But you need to go at least half. So you're going to go above, usually by a half inch or more, above your liquid line, if that helps. And then remember, as I start spinning and diluting, and I'm actually going to move this over here so we can get a good look at it. And as I stir and spin, all the rest of that ice then compacts and starts melting a little bit. And since we let it dilute for a couple seconds over there, doesn't need to dilute too much longer. I'm going to go ahead and pour mine. Pardon Pikachu. Thanks for keeping my glass cold. Now, John, for the Yari, you can either do a regular Hawthorne strainer or you can do a tulip strainer like this. The julep strainer works well because you're not putting it over, or you don't have any pulp to strain out. This is all just sugar and booze and bitters. All right. Now, if you would, here I thought I wasn't going to forget anything, but of course I did. Only thing I need, John, and I think you already have yours, is I need my orange peel. Go figure.
I'll never forget it.
Right? Got it ready? So we're going to do a fun, different thing with our orange peel today before you get started.
Oh.
We're going to do nothing too crazy. We just thought we'd try a little something fun. And we're going to go for a least efficient peel, but a little bit bigger, wider, pretty peel. So we can do something fancy and show everybody out there, right? So what I want you to do, John, is I want you to actually... down here. We're going to go, here's the bottom of your orange. And I want you to go at an angle. See how I'm not quite straight up and down, which I would do if I were at the bar because I could get six peels, nice wide peels out of this. But instead, I'm going to go from this corner and I'm going to come follow it down and come all the way to the other side. So look how big we got there. And since we're doing this fantastic...
It's making like an extra long peel. It's the same sort of peel, just as long as possible.
Yep. And it ends up looking almost like you're going around the outside, but you're coming down in an S pattern. This is going to be a great juicing orange, but the peels are getting a little soft. So that gave way right at the end. We're going to make it work anyway. So for this one, I'm going to start by making it teardropped on both ends, almost like a leaf. Okay. Y'all, thank you so much for liking that soundtrack. John has put a lot of work into it, and it is fantastic to hear on our end as well. Now, we got that almost leaf-looking looking peel. I'm going to change it around just a little bit. I'm going to do a quick little slit about the same shape as the leaf right in the middle. And then I'm going to do five small cuts. And the way I'm going to do those cuts, turn this around here, is I'm going to go at an angle down towards this tip that I picked to be the front. And then I'm going to go one out, just like that. And then pop out that little triangle. And then one more time right back here. So one at an angle, one straight on. We're going to come back. I'm going to do the same thing on this side. We don't want them to match up perfectly evenly because, you know what? As symmetrical as Mother Nature is, sometimes it's off just by enough that we can appreciate the imperfection. All right. So we got that pretty looking leaf to help bring us back to that rum idea. Now, I'm going back to my orange one more time, John, because we got a pretty orange peel, right? And that's going to be our fantastic garnish to sink in there. And I'm going to put that right along the side of my BFC. But I really want to have that fresh orange peel on the nose. So I'm going to pull one more peel off. Try and get a nice thick one here. And I'm going to bring down that peel just flat so everybody sees it nice and easy. Then we're going to take it and give it a nice little squeeze. And I'm not sure if the camera can get it right now, but we had a nice mist of fresh orange oil go right over the top of this cocktail. Iguana,
you're discarding that one?
And we don't need that one. Yep, we can just set it to the side. Because all we want is that orange oil right on the top. And we already have enough floating in there for the rest of the cocktail. But the idea is that we're going to get that nice orange oil right on the nose. And it's going to help brighten the cocktail. It's kind of interesting how different fruit peels work when we're working with them. And the differences they make in the way we perceive our cocktails. And while John's finishing up, I'm going to go in and take a little sip just for posterity's sake. Of course, everybody. I hate it. Just kidding. Yeah.
I don't know. Did I come up with the leaf okay?
I think that looks good. Hey, mine's not perfect either. The idea is that we're freeing ourselves to like just try and have a little bit of fun.
I'm pretty excited we did this. Yours looked really good. Plus, why did it around the cube?
Yep, just along the outside.
All right. I think I'm caught up. Got my oils on there.
Cheers, sir. Looking nice and tropical, huh?
Cheers.
Cheers.
Oh my gosh, that's so easy to drink.
Smooth, right? Now, do you get the chocolate as the first notes on the exhale?
Yeah, the chocolate is lovely.
And see, the maple, this is my favorite thing about maple. Again, another perceived thing that people a lot of times are sure they really dislike. But I love being able to hide it in something for somebody and change their perception just enough. Just tweak it. And that is that maple, it can be, is a great low glycemic, sweetener. And it's really, it adds a richness, without adding just sugary sweetness to things. We're trying. Kinderliff, we are working hard to bring great garnish game your way. In fact, it's our passion, and we figure whatever we can do to make it a little bit more fun for everybody out there who's willing to join us. Yeah. This particular cocktail in Portland would have to be at least $12 to $15. And that's with as an old-fashioned with the least amount of ingredients, but you're taking the time to stir it. Solera or Santa Teresa isn't the cheapest. It's affordable, but it's also why we're having an old-fashioned where we can sip it. Yeah, 15's probably what most of us would have to charge to keep our bars at where they should be. But I'd say on average, you can get this bottle, depends on the bottle and the cost. So this bottle, I think you can get from anywhere from $33 to $39. And that makes a difference at, that'll make it
plus the
almost $1.50.
Don't forget the peel work. That garnish game is well. Yours right? Is better, but you know that took time. That's $5 right there.
Right, but more importantly, do you feel good about it? Like, does it feel good to like produce something like that?
Yeah, this drink feels good. I mean, you mean for the customer?
Yeah, and for yourself. Yes. Right now. Yeah. Like you should feel great because you accomplished that one on your own. And as we do these more, we're able to add more and more to it. I feel like putting some of these things within reach for all of us in our houses really opens us up to trusting ourselves a little bit more. And opens all of us up to creating new cocktails. Who knows what somebody's going to come up with out there that my career has made me think that I shouldn't do, like rum, right? That's why we're doing this, right, John? Be able to introduce people to a bunch of things that maybe you thought wasn't rich or wasn't fancy or was supposed to be with coconut milk.
Yeah, or whiskey.
Right. Which is why I like the alternative with this, because it just gives a nice balanced richness. There's oak, but it's not charred oak. It's not the same kind of predominant flavor that you're getting with bourbon. And no corn, obviously, too. That makes a huge difference. Now, do you feel like there is enough of the aromatic coffee pecan spice? Because I'm not getting a lot on my nose, in fact.
Sorry, which one?
The spiced pecan.
Yeah, so when I tried that by itself on my hand, I was in love.
I think we need more of it in this cocktail. In fact, I wished we would have put a little bit right onto the cube before we did it, because it would have helped. So let's try another 5 drops.
Oh, it's so good by itself. If only this were potable liquor.
Right?
You're not supposed to drink it by itself.
It's not potable liquor. Yeah, you're not supposed to. Well, and only because of, you have to think about the ingredients that happen to go in there. When it comes to the bittering agents, which happen to be fantastic digestifs, and add different layers of bitterness as far as depths of flavor. But they could hurt your stomach in huge high amounts. Everybody remembers a trip to the toilet after Jaeger, like in college, and you're like, oh my God, I'll never drink Jaeger again. But Jaeger's a fortified, very heavily spiced liqueur that isn't. It's kind of made the same way as bitters, with a lot of the same bittering agents. In fact, huge amount of gentian root in there.
Yeah, there's an adult way to enjoy Jaeger. Don't write it off.
Right, exactly. Just like everything else that we're trying to do here, we're trying to open everybody up to new flavors and not close off. And Jaeger is an Amaro, whether you like it or not. It happens to be strong, and we all had, I think we had an era of it with Red Bull that probably was the Red Bull that ruined it for us. But yeah, there it does. It has legs just like a Verna Amaro and Punta Mess and different things like that. In fact, Fernet, I feel like, and which is like quote unquote the bartender's handshake, Fernet and Jaeger are really similar in their flavor profile. They're wintergreen and they're mint, especially on the finish. The spiced pecan bitters, I was on a roll with all these new flavors, and I was trying to put them together in a well-balanced way, but I wanted to introduce some new, richer flavors into that. In fact, the spiced pecan was partially inspired by a black walnut bitters idea that I had, but somebody introduced me to frankincense. And there happens to be a little bit of frankincense in that particular bitters. And I find it to be unique, and most people don't even know what's in there. In fact, I just gave away a secret right there. But things like that, when I start building anything, I start utilizing the flavors that I have in front of me and try and balance them out. So sometimes I start off with an idea and I need to be adaptable with that throughout it. And that's how that spiced pecan came about. The first ideas were to make a bitters that reminded me of mole. And then I realized I wanted to dial it back when I tasted the pecans a little bit more, and I actually added extra pecans after the initial like 3 days of the first 3 days of it steeping. Yeah, we all are very happy that you did not have a Red Bull Jaeger experience in your era. That is fantastic. You didn't miss out on anything. In fact, I can't even smell Red Bull anymore without instantly going back to hot, sweaty college nights.
Used to serve or bartend in a college bar, right?
I did, yeah. I'd say that I started off in my grandfather's bar, making Manhattans and old fashions and things like that with him. But my first official bar and bartending job was at a college bar right across the street from ASU called Dos Gringos. And
Were you one of the gringos?
I was not. Pete and Brian were the two gringos that started this thing. And in fact, Brian was the first one. He had a little tiny place that he sold just, he popped beers out of a cooler, I remember, to start. I started going there long before I was legally supposed to. But I remember when they first opened, they had a small room just off when they first started doing food, and there was a woman who would just make handmade tortillas right there and get them ready, and they just started making like basic tacos and nachos and things like that, and it was fantastic. That was the first place, and they were totally different. Lots of margaritas and tons of different shots. And shots get to be complex as well. Surfers on Acid, and they had amazing names like Redheaded Slut and all these other
What is a surfer
different
on
things.
acid?
See if I remember it right. Surf, it's been a while. Surfer on Acid, I think, is Malibu. Malibu pineapple and cranberry, maybe.
The only reason I ask about the college
Maybe that one
bartending
had
experience is, maybe we
Jaeger.
can tie it back to Jaeger. I'm guessing you served a lot of Jaeger at the time.
Yeah, and I actually that's what I was trying to think of. It's either that or the Redheaded Slut that actually has Jaeger in it. And it might be
Oh,
that
one of them
because like
does,
it's
yeah.
one of them does, yeah. And I think that I would want to say that it's the one with the pineapple, because of the fact that we're right back to where we were with our first cocktail. Pineapple and some spices tend to work fantastically together. I don't. I The movie cocktail is okay. I think that's a great question, Maddie Light. I think that it is hilarious. Actually, I'll tell you my most memorable and part is the fact that he goes around looking for how to make a, oh, what was it? It was a rum and coke with lime. And in our business, people like to order cocktails that have lots of different names, Bay Breeze, Sea Breeze, different things like that, that could just be cranberry and rum and cranberry or rum cranberry and orange juice. And when you're really busy, and a lot of times people have the names wrong, which is my favorite, or maybe even the ingredients wrong, but they insist you make it for them and it's terrible, but you're doing it just because that's what you're there to do. But within the movie Cocktail, he searches around looking for the name of this cocktail in all the cocktail books, and then he finally realizes it's a goddamn rum and coke with lime in it. Why the hell didn't this person just say it's a goddamn rum and coke with lime in it? And there's no more apropos experience for any bartender out there than that particular thing. Oh, John, perfect example. The paper plane. The very first time I even knew what that cocktail was, somebody introduced it to me and they called it a paper bag. And they were like, "Hey, will you make this paper bag for me?" And I was like, "I don't, all right." And I was working at a place called Bamboo Sushi and I had all the ingredients that he thought were in it. And it was not balanced and a three, I think it was a, I think it's a four or five ingredient cocktail, and two of the ingredients were totally wrong. And you're just like, oh, okay. And I look up, I spent the whole rest of the night after work looking up paper bag, could not find it. Finally realized, oh no, it's a paper plane. Everybody likes it's an old classic cocktail. It's a paper plane. So.
I'm laughing at grocery bag.
Right? Yeah. No, it was paper bag. Paper bag, not paper. And by the taste of it, I was like, hey, it's... The taste will fit. It tastes like it should be in a paper bag right now.
but hold on. He's describing this thing with pretty exquisite ingredients, right? He's not asking for the traditional shot. He's asking for bourbon and Amaro and Nonino and right?
Yeah, he wanted rye whiskey. If I'm remembering it correctly, it's rye whiskey, Aperol, Campari and lemon juice. And I hope I'm saying rye whiskey right. It could have been gin. But there was no so the difference between the orange Amaro that we're talking about in Aperol and the sugar, basically it came out, it had no balance and it was just tart. Just sour and hot. And even the guy took a drink of it and went, okay. You know, and I was like, really? You want that? And he's like, no, that's kind of it. Well, yeah, and Amaro Nonino has that nice, rich roundness to it. A little bit more of a fortified wine than a sharp orange liqueur, I feel like. And it was a 1.5 ounces of lemon juice. To 1.5 ounces of bourbon.
What this guy said right off to you. Or,
so it was just like, you know what it tasted like? It tasted like if you added if it was just lemon and bourbon and you added something that made it even bitterer. And lemon and bourbon without any like sort of sweetener to balance it out is already just bitter. So it's, it was interesting. And I think it was Bullet Rye of all things too. Now that we're talking about rye. And which is why I'm thinking of this, because Bullet Rye in itself happens to be a little bit more of a dilly, bright kind of rye whiskey. A little bit more on the sides of like a Wild Turkey 101, where it isn't your Rittenhouse rye, where it's like got a heavy spice profile and nice, rich age to it. Brighter and sharper. So yeah, the whole thing was a hot mess. And it was a paper bag, literally. I'll never forget it.
So is there a brown paper bag? Tarp Tarts is asking.
No, there is not one called a brown paper bag. You and I might have to come up with that, John.
Not on this show.
You never know.
Unless we have like an April Fool's episode.
Right. Or you just pull it out of a paper bag and it's just this beautiful cocktail. Actually, all of a sudden, just going through my mind was like, what could we do with oat milk? And like something dark like that. You could make that into a paper bag color. And who knows?
Oh, you have the color of the cocktail to be a paper bag.
You could. It would be the only way. Whoa. I think I could tie it in together. Otherwise, we'd have to be funded like Canon in Seattle, where they have like fantastic riffs of like a little ceramic, what looks like a little ceramic paper bag with a straw coming out of it. Like,
well,
that you wouldn't need any visual.
That's amazing. I was just going to mention Canon because they had a drink there, I think called Whole Paycheck, as a reference to Whole Foods.
Yeah,
and it came in a miniature grocery bag in a miniature shopping cart.
Of course it did. That sounds exactly right. Yeah, that sounds right up their alley, right? I love that. In fact, if anybody is streaming us tonight up in Seattle, please go see Canon. They are, I know they are not selling the amounts that they wanted to be selling. I just saw an Instagram post from them like 2 days ago that said that they went from having like 30 sales a day on average, which could keep them which could not make them any profit but sustain them through this to 7 sales a day the next week, and that they won't be able to shut their doors or won't be able to keep their doors open, which is crazy too, because they've not only have they been groundbreaking in the cocktails that they're willing to make and the presentation that they're willing to do, but they have a fantastic collection of different spirits that the owner has collected for many, many years. In fact, if I were in Seattle right now, I'd have a bottle of Fitzgerald in my hand, because what are the chances you could get your hands on things like that right now?
What does that normally cost?
I don't know, but it's that hard to get that I haven't seen it on the OLCC website as far as price listing goes in the last 3 years since I've been buying. And
A little more restricted with the way we get liquor here in Oregon State. So yeah. Canon up in Seattle has a enviable collection.
Oh yeah, there's no limits. They can get it on sale at BevMo, in fact, if they want to, which is amazing to think about the possibilities that we could have. Since we're talking about rum, John, let's talk about the fact that you and I can't even get one of our favorite rums. You helped me cut my teeth on. Yeah.
I mean, that one, everything I would. Yeah.
And you can get it in Washington and you can get it in California and Idaho, but apparently a distributor here there was some issue and they won't sell it to Oregon anymore, which is a shame. So it's like, yeah, all tied up into our system.
Yeah.
But I will say I have met some fantastic people that work for and have been elected since I met them to the board for the OLCC. And they're willing to listen and bring in new product if we find out about them. We just sometimes need others to help us find out about them so we can petition them to bring them in and we can introduce them to the rest of our guests here in town. And who knows? I mean, with this going with our streaming, maybe we can have somebody introduce some new things to us from all over the world, and we can show them off to everybody here on Twitch and at Thirsty Therapy. That'd be pretty fun.
You know, I'm kind of stuck on this paper bag idea, April Fool's idea. Iguana suggested it has to be evocative of drinking out of a paper bag at a racetrack. I think we got to go for that. Can't get it out of my head.
So would we, give us your thoughts out there. Would we need a straw? Would this have to be sipped out of a straw via a paper bag? Or would this have to be, because that helps us determine the type of cocktail that we'll create. Would it have to be something that we could actually tip back through a paper bag? Give us your thoughts. We'll make the bag cute too. We'll figure out some way, right, John?
I'm going to sleep on it. Yeah. I'm sure I'm going to have dreams about it tonight.
Right. Right. That and El Dorado 5-Year.
Together at last.
Right. That's awesome.
Drinking really, I mean, it's not super expensive liquor, but it's nicer than a paper bag would. Yeah. I don't know. It's amusing to put it in a paper bag and drink it that way.
Yeah, well, now I'm a little, I mean, to be honest with all of you, I'm a little intrigued to be able to put it to fruition, because I always had a very underhanded comment about Old Crow whiskey and that it tasted like the paper bag it should be drank out of. So, I think that it's only fitting now that I turn around my snide remarks into a cocktail. I still don't think I can put Old Crow in it, but some other cocktail that we put in a paper bag. Thanks so much for joining us, Matty Light. We'll see you soon again. And we can't wait.
What's the requirement to be a regular? What's the requirement to be a regular at this bar? You tip well.
Yeah. You come with good positivity and you enjoy and interact, and that's it.
Oh, you're lowballing. We gotta put more requirements on that.
We'll add to it. That's why I need you, sir. You'll teach me the ways.
You're too nice and I'm too mean. We'll meet in the middle.
Right? I mean, can you get a better, like, right where we need to be? Oh, man. I am certainly happy with this. And the other thing that I appreciate is with this, the Solera rum and the viscosity is, even as it softens and it dilutes more and more, and it, again, with that BFC, it's not diluting really too quickly. We still got a real nice heavy cube in there, but it keeps its flavor. It still stays nice. It's almost highball-y by the end.
Yeah, this is good. I just, especially with that extra, the spiced pecan bitters.
It needed it.
We added 5 at the end. Yeah, that's the only modification, and it's great. Yeah.
But I completely agree. Now we get the bitter cacao first, but finishing with the spice and a little bit of richness. Mm. Well, and that brings up too, we're heading into the season now. I've actually started a whole new set of bitters production, and we'll see what we can start working with here for the rest of the year. I want to do another black walnut, and I've got, my favorite thing is the area that we're in now. I have such an abundance of fresh and locally produced ingredients that I can use here. And black walnuts from a fantastic farm out past Tigard. I'm going to turn into a black walnut bitters, and then we're going to do another round of this, a new batch of this spice pecan, because believe it or not, John, you and I have the last remnants in these teeny tiny 15 mil bottles of all that has ever existed of that particular bitters. So hold on to it until we produce more. But oddly enough, I've been, because people have liked this flavor so much, I've had people offer up fantastic ingredients for it that they know I use. So I had somebody bring me back a frankincense tear from Syria. I have a good large amount of that to use. And like all the bits that I need, I have, I can get here and get locally, and it tastes that much better. Man, Oregon hazelnuts. Yeah. I'd love to do a little bit more with Oregon hazelnuts. Chestnuts for sure. Chestnuts won't give us the bitter flavor. They won't actually extract. And hazelnuts, they are a little bit harder too. My favorite so far that I've had with hazelnuts is turning them into an orgeat, which is almost like a hazelnut milk syrup, if you will, where you blanch the hazelnuts and let them steep and soak and cook them down with spices and sugars. And then refrigerate it and you add it. The thing I love about orgeat is it adds a incredible viscosity to your cocktail that you would, that just knocks you on your feet. It's really, really cool. It just adds to the different experience and the depth level of your cocktail. With, again, not adding too much sugary sweetness to it. Yeah. Anything that can do that is a cool thought. In fact, John, how many cocktails can you think of right off the top of your head that you have had with orgeat in them?
Mai Tai is the most popular one, right?
Right. That's an almond orgeat, the original.
Okay. True. I've never had any other kind.
Well, which the almond orgeat is great. It has that. It tends, I feel like, in Mai Tais, and kind of like what we were talking about earlier with the spices and the funkiness, it lends its flavor to those really well, that marzipan flavor that you end up getting out of the orgeat. But some of these add almost a rich toastiness to it. In fact, the pecans and the walnuts you can't necessarily even use without giving them a little bit of toasting them just a little bit. Chestnuts I love, and they're medicinally fantastic, but they just don't add it's almost too watery of a nut to really give a lot of flavor. We all like the texture and the chewiness of it, but I would describe it like apples. And bear with me, because it's like finishing apple season right now. But in all my experiences with experimenting with flavors, my job isn't always to give you the exact purest flavor of something. It's to help manage your perception of that flavor. So quite often, if you have something with strawberries, if we were to use fresh strawberries in a cocktail or make a strawberry preserve or something with strawberries, we'd add a little bit of lemon, mainly because that brightens it up. And we would try and pick a particular type of strawberry to give you a true strawberry flavor. While Hood strawberries happen to be my favorite strawberry to eat, which is a local strawberry, you can't steep them or get any strawberry flavor out of them. It just kind of tastes like a sweet flavor reminiscent of some sort of berry, but it doesn't taste like strawberry. Same with apples. I could get a Honeycrisp apple and I could cook it down, or I could put it into Everclear and try and make a bitters out of it, and it would come out tasting lightly sweet, not at all like apple. However, there are certain other apples that really have that quintessential apple flavor that as I serve it to you, you go, oh, that's apple. And that's regardless of whether or not I tell you it's apple. It has all the flavor combinations and profiles that you expect from an apple. And that is one of my favorites so far, is called a wine sap apple, which is, John, it's super heavy and dense, almost heavier and more dense than a Granny Smith apple. And it's dark red, and you cut into it and it almost looks like it's bleeding because the peel, it has so much tannins in it. As you cut through it, those tannins slice, like kind of bleed onto the apple part itself. But that is one of the few apples that I've found where we could steep it and actually get a lot of apple flavor when you're done. And I find things like that amazingly interesting, that it doesn't always give you, oh, I can take that ingredient, put it in here, but if I serve it to anyone or even to myself, it doesn't taste like what I expected it to by name. Does that make sense?
Steeping it into what form?
Even an extract. Like that, if you think about it, that's the purest form of anything is going to be an extract, right? Most of them are a lot of them are distilled, but some of them are just steeped botanicals that are steeped in a high proof alcohol. Not all the flavors come through that way. Normally you need to warm it to release some of the oils, but otherwise that's the purest way to find your flavor. And even then it doesn't always come through unless you have like the right kind of apple or the right kind of strawberry, which isn't necessarily the one that you're going to find readily available at your grocery store or most of the year. The Driscoll is not going to be the strawberry that you can steep and get a strawberry, great strawberry flavor. But it's bigger, red, and juicy and looks like a strawberry.
So turning our attention to the immediate holiday season, Kinderlift asks about.
I was just looking at that. You're right.
Yeah. What about Thanksgiving, for example? Do we do eggnog? What goes with that?
Well, I think nobody wants to have an eggnog for the heaviest meal of the day, even though I love eggnog. There are some definite fall cocktails. In fact, John, you and I were just talking about our next round of filming for Thirsty Therapy. We were going to work on some of those cocktails, some fall flavored cocktails. But what we are what we're thinking about, and everybody's feeling that you're moving into warmer, cozier, richer, a little bit heavier times. I feel like as I gear up with more and more clothes, I gear up with warmer and cozier cocktails. So when I think about that, I think about heavier spices, which is exactly why we didn't go with a bright lemongrass flavor when we made our cocktail, when we made our first pineapple cocktail today. If I were in the middle of the summer, I might want some things to brighten that flavor up. But in fact, we're transitioning. I want a little bit of that spice. I want to give a hint of where we're headed. Maple is the other reason that that's actually coming into season right now too, where I use maple a lot heavier during the winter time and the fall and early spring as well. It has a place at any time of the year depending on what you need it for, but I feel like the richness is perfect for this time of year and moving in. So Kinderlift, more specifically right now, I'm thinking about for our next time. John and I already talked about doing a fantastic cocktail with some pear and some spice notes to it. In fact, we have Clear Creek, which is a fantastic, in fact, world-renowned brandy maker here in the Northwest. And they have probably the most consistent and well-made brandy that I know of. I'm open to it. Again, I am never here to stop learning. John isn't. Neither are all of you, I hope. So as we go, if any of you know more, teach us, let us know. If there's something we're missing, please reach out to us and let us know about it. You can reach us at our website or our Instagram as well. And I think you can still leave messages here too, right, John?
Yeah, you can follow us and whisper and
perfect.
Soon like and subscribe and pay us monies.
All those things. That would be fantastic.
Tip your bartender.
Right?
One day.
But in the meantime, let's all take care of each other. You give me good stuff, I'll try and share anything that I got with you. This brain never stops trying to twist and come up with new unique flavors and create a fun new taste, not only for myself, but for everybody else to experience. Right, John? I mean, how fun is it to just go, what are we going to taste this week? And you come up with the base, and then it sends me on a whole new flurry of trying to come up with some flavors to match that.
Yeah, man. I'm trying to, you know, recreate our days of me sitting across the bar from you, not as your bar back, but as your guest. And you try something out on me, and I say, nah, too juicy or too muddy. You need something to tie it together. You work with that, and we come up with something together. Very invigorating.
That's what it should be like. I'm making cocktails for all of you out there as well as myself, but I can't be the be all end all of flavors. I'm willing to try weirder, funkier, maybe not so awesome things to you out there, but I might like them. Bartenders are weird for what we're willing to taste and try, and then what we're not always knowing that our general crowd is going to like, but really being able to push those boundaries just a little, nudge you in a new direction to open you up. That's really what makes our day and makes it more worthwhile than anything else. And this is the closest thing we have to that fantastic bar setting right now, John. And I think it's opened, not only opened it up a lot for you and I, Kinderlift, but and everyone else who's willing to join us from not just our area, but all around the world. We can give each other a little bit of therapy and a little bit of normalcy, a little bit of like real talk and tasty cocktails. Man, I think we're doing okay. Could be worse.
Man, this is the therapy I needed after this week.
Yeah, you and me both. And it is helping.
Yes. Absolutely.
Mm. So now for the rest of the week, when does the TT bar open? Man. We are working
this
on
is
that,
it,
Kinderlift.
Right? We're
this
open.
Is there we're here. We're there for you. We got everything well, you need.
Well,
what was that, John?
Everything except the ingredients.
But we're working on that too,
make
right?
This at home. He doesn't have spice pecan bitters or even Portland Project cacao bitters. You know, how did he know?
True.
What can
but
we
we're
do
working
there?
On that
can we bring
too,
the
right? Vodka,
then?
We're trying. In fact, right now we are working on trying to get all of our things tied up so that we can have these bitters available for everybody, as well as our different the different syrups that we have to come up with. That way, we're making things accessible for you within your home, and you can follow along with us and experiment without us, and let us know what you've been coming up with, and try some new things. In fact, yeah, hopefully here pretty quick we'll be able to start offering up at least a few things on Etsy, and a few more things within the next few months if we do everything right. But for now, we get to actually interact and see everybody and have a good time with you. And yeah, and if we can keep teaching and learning, man, how fun will this be? Also, for any of you out there that are streaming fans as much as we are and gamers, let us know who you like and what you like to see as far as our all of our little friends here all around. We're lucky enough to have a plethora of gaming characters in and out of my world. So whether it be mine, my sons, my daughters, or my wife's, we're gaming nerds too. So let us know what you like to see, and we'll add even more.
Oh yeah, can you step into my apartment real quick, Billy? I got my gaming. It's kind of hard to see. Let's see. Now you're in my apartment.
Nice.
It's really tiny, but I did bring one gaming figurine. That's probably two.
It's so small. I thought it was a beef eater.
it's a Tracer and beef eater.
Nice.
I figured Tracer's, she's British, right? So she would probably drink London Dry gin.
Oh, absolutely. The original scurvy scare. London Dry gin, lime, and sugar. That's awesome. Yeah, that rum old fashioned, you should give it a shot if you can. It is tasty and rich. The one thing that you need to remember about a rum old fashioned, because of its lessened oak, is the fact that it needs half as much time in stirring. The viscosity is going to stay there. You're going to add another cube, at least a small cube, to it as it's finished. So remember to do, you're going to shorten your stirring time to about half as much as you would do for a regular old fashioned. You're not trying to introduce as much of that sugar viscosity into the rum as you are when you are with whiskey. Whiskey's much harsher. John's got the best bitters bottles. I have to agree with you on that. The fact that he has actually full-on Dasher bottles is even better. So if you needed to try and do something different other than spiced pecan bitters, I would say that a great substitution for the immediate moment, if you can get your hands on it, is going to be Angostura, and I'm sure you already have some. When it comes to that, the other spice that I would try and add to it, if you have any around, and you can't get the coffee pecan, would be a little bit of the Portland Bitter Project bitter cacao, and maybe just a light sprinkling of cinnamon, super light sprinkling of cinnamon, and just ground cinnamon. If you have any of that. In fact, John, you know that I have a cinnamon orange cocktail that we use cinnamon extract for, but we use only one drop of it because it's so strong. Even something like that would be way too strong for the flavor profile that you want with a rum old fashioned. but I'm glad you're checking in. I love that you want to know. Now, will it decrease your lag? Kinderlif.
I like that question.
Digital lag or my mental lag?
It's a rumor. He's starting a rumor.
Uh-oh. Then I need to drink a lot more of it. Because I've said at least 40 times too many tonight. Man. We definitely got to make more of that bitters, though. You're right, John. I love how it finishes on the end, too. So how'd you enjoy it tonight, John? You like all the rums? You feel like we need to expand even more and do another rum night in another couple months?
Oh, well, I could go deep on rum. But, I mean, there's so many other spirits to cover. However, you know, since we're heading into the colder months here in the...
That's right.
In the Northern Hemisphere. You know, I think I mentioned eggnog and I don't know, rum hot toddies earlier. Like, we could do those right. We could definitely do an episode just around those.
We could do those right. I will say that for eggnog, for the most part, we can make a quick nog. One thing I've learned in my many years of bartending is that the best way and the coolest way and the actual most scientifically safe and effective way to have eggnog is actually aged eggnog. So it's not a quick nog. So maybe what we should do is, since we're talking about that, is we should do a video where I'll make a batch of, and we can upload it, where I make a batch of eggnog and then everybody can try it and then we can taste it a few weeks later. Because the idea is that your eggnog actually has to sit for at least 6 weeks, I believe, and we'll double check before we make our new video for that. But I believe it is the minimum of 6 weeks that you need to let your eggnog age for to drop down to make it actually the safest way it could be. And I would have never known. I believe Harvard was the one that did the study that I secondarily, I read. And then, oddly enough, as I was looking it up, I think PBS did a special on it because of the publishment of Harvard's study. But it happened to be an eggnog that they were making at Harvard traditionally for more than 60 years. And don't quote me, I could be off by a decade or more. But it was a great many decades that they had been doing the same one for. And they decided to study it based on E. coli and different things, different factors that could be that you could be exposed to in that. And it is like amazing how the drop off is the fact that you actually age it. You can have the same amount of alcohol in it for the first week or two, but it doesn't actually change anything. You're just as, if you actually have E. coli introduced to there, you're just as susceptible. But as soon as you get to that 6 week mark, completely drops off and it is 100% food safe from that point on.
So what you're saying is don't drink all those whole eggs like I did last Christmas time. Don't do that.
It all depends. For eggnog. Eggnog is traditionally brandy, though, and not necessarily rum, and not necessarily heavily fortified with a lot of alcohol. Now, three years ago, you and I introduced a cocktail with a whole egg into it, utilizing Japanese whiskey. Now, that happened to be, that we tested that as well, and that happened to be food safe. The difference between the two is that the ratio of alcohol and whiskey to that one was so much higher. The alcohol was able to inoculate that amount of it. So if you raise up and you're especially safe with what you're using, pasteurized eggs as well, always help give you that one extra step of safety, especially when it's coming to your guests. When you're at home, you can take bigger chances at, but yet we still, anything that we're going to give you, we still want to give you the most, the safest ideas of it. And then from there, I'm not at your house to stop you from slap your hand from drinking it 2 weeks early, and things like that. And you might be most likely, you'll probably be fine. But it,
2 weeks early, 10 seconds.
Right. Who knows, really, if you add an extra couple of ounces of whiskey to it, because you can handle it, that might be enough to change the game altogether as well. So that was, yeah. And in fact, I think that you and I'm going to find the link to either the study or the video, whichever I can find first. And we will try and connect that to and leave that out there for anybody to be able to try and find. Whoever wants to find it. Then that way you can see exactly what we're talking about and have a little bit of reference before we bring more to you in the following weeks. Yes, exactly. Just in time for Christmas. I better get to work, in fact, to make it happen. In the meantime, what we're going to be working with the next few weeks is we're going to be working with those fall flavors. So we won't go straight into Christmas and eggnogs and stuff. Like I said, we're going to be doing pears are in great season, apple, things like that. We'll probably be working with some bourbons, I believe some apple brandies, some pear brandies, and we're going to slowly transition into these heavier spice flavors at a different time of year. It's the privilege that I've been given to live in a place that has a fantastic amount of seasons and has new things to offer through each one of those seasons that I've always longed for, and I'm very excited to try and do things and share things with everybody out there as seasonally as we can make them. So we're going to try and keep up with that. Now, that means that I've been lucky enough to be making a lot of these cocktails for years past and have practiced knowing what I'm going to be coming up with for as far as flavor profiles and as far as things that are going to be available to us. In fact, John, you know my love for fresh bergamot in another... By January, mid-January, we'll have fresh bergamot, a whole different style of citrus and a different aromatics to work with. So I'm glad you all think it sounds delicious. I can't wait to share more with all of you. Yeah. John, how do you feel about tonight? Did you have a good time?
Oh, yes. I make a point of not quite finishing every drink. Don't want, you know... To get too drunk on camera. You remember what happened last time.
Right.
Never again. But I had to finish this old fashioned. It was delightful. I'm feeling very good.
Yay, I'm so glad. Well, it helps that we're not trying to make three or four drinks in a matter of 2 hours. And that we're only sticking with two.
Watch me get ripped and suggest, let's add two more to the agenda.
There's always time. I still keep thinking about having like a backup, one backup for us just in case. Oh, bergamot is so good. In fact, here's the funny part about bergamot. I'd have to share this with everybody before we let them go. I happen to have worked with and know the owners of Bitterman's Bitters here in town. And they were the first ones to that I started introducing all my bergamot creations too. And they actually let me know, they let me know that there was that too much bergamot apparently is not good for you. And there is a synthetic kind that you can use that is null of any of this, some sort of oil that can be known as a carcinogen, which I was like, holy, I got to find out more about that. And then it turns out that the amount that we would ever share with anybody is so small that would never actually affect or hurt anyone except in large quantities. But to have people wanting to share that knowledge with you and finding out new things constantly about these fantastic flavors and constantly trying to look out for our guests and look out for all of you and ourselves and keep us safe. And it's quite a daunting task, but a lot of fun if you have the time to do the research to get into this. And in fact, I brought all that up because there's a website called cocktailsafe.com. And that is a place that any of you can go to check out different ingredients that you may be running, that you may find out there. And make sure you know what you're using is legit, as opposed to just somebody telling you that it's this is a fantastic thing. Because there are ingredients out there that I've even gotten in cocktail and bitters making kits that are ones that I have made sure that to know that I can't use. But they're a readily available bittering agent, and some people are just willing to use those. So be careful out there. Check out cocktailsafe.com. That's a great place to be. Yes, photosynthesis too. That's the other part. It does. It makes your skin, it will burn your skin in the sun. You're 1,000% right, Iguana. Well, everybody, we want to thank you. John, you want to say anything to everybody who joined us tonight?
Thanks. It's like it's almost the closest we can get to being back at sitting in a bar. I appreciate you all.
Yeah, it's great having you all. Let us know what you got. If you have any questions for us, if you have any feedback, camera angles and everything else, we feel like we're really starting to dial it in. John worked amazingly hard on that fantastic music that we have playing for you. And yeah, thank you all for showing up. We can't wait to see you for the next one. We will send out invitations. It'll probably be in 2 or 3 weeks. Have a great rest of your night, everybody. Thanks for joining us. Bye.